You won't find Hatesville on any maps. It's easy to get to, but you can't go by train, a plane, or car. You need a ticket to get there from here. And you're listening to that ticket this very minute, Dad. A one-way ticket, first class. See, Hatesville exists partway between the heart and the mind. It's that place in the soul where hate dwells, and we're here to point the way. Why? Because hate is groovy. Because it's fun, and it's necessary, and it lives inside you every second of every day. And know what? You need hate. And we need to let you hate, because we're your friends. And we want to see you happy, and healthy, and just a little bit angry. So don't hold back or hesitate. Sit back, smile, relax, and hate. Everyone needs a scapegoat. Everyone needs a whipping boy. When you find someone to hate, it fills your heart with joy.
Race riot, and all the people of all races, black, white, yellow, and brown, stop their shooting and stomping and screaming long enough to call a truce and have a barbecue. There's so damn many yellow people, the other races felt crowded. The white people made a profit on the barbecue, which angered the black people, who in turn vandalized their picnic area. Some brown people did a drive-by shooting, and then some Jews walked on down and sold everybody guns. And then police came by to confiscate those guns. At that moment when tensions were highest, when all the races were ready to resume the riot, a mulatto newscaster came on the television news and said, the latest poll declared that everyone felt much safer now that their guns were confiscated, whereupon the races turned their attention from each other to their television sets. Each one shooting out the cathode ray tubes like a bunch of Elvises on peanut butter sandwiches. All the races were temporarily so happy with this that they cooled the interracial violence, Dig. Oh, but there were so damn many yellow people that the other races felt crowded. And the white people made a profit on an additional barbecue, which angered the black people, who in turn vandalized a picnic area. And at that moment when tensions were highest, when all the races were ready to resume the riot, a mulatto newscaster came on the television news and said, the latest poll declared that everyone felt much safer now that their guns were confiscated.
The dog snarled and leapt at the young woman, I'll never forget that look of pure horror on her face as that dog brought her to the ground, screaming for help. I held my stomach, doubled over, gleefully laughing. The way the blood spurted out of her jugular vein reminded me of a hose left unattended. I also will never forget her face when she finally spotted me at the top of my stairs, pink in the face from laughing so hard, tears streaming down my face. I'm not sure exactly what she was thinking at that point, but I'm sure it was something equally amusing.
In a city by a sea, at 20 Romolo, apartment B, I've come to surprise a whiny swine who once long ago was a friend of mine. I'm calling tonight to settle a debt. It's nearly 6 years and he owes me yet. I buzz the apartment, saying it's express mail. Big lovely package for Mr. V. Vale. And even though the hour's late, he buzzes me through the security gate. The door swings open, not a word is said, as I step inside, holding a gun to his head. He's scared and confused. I say, what'd you expect? There's a debt overdue, and I'm here to collect. It would have been such a small price to pay, cheaper by far than your judgment day. But that's a lesson you'll soon see. When I pay you what you owe me. As I cock the gun's hammer, he starts to weep. So I say, shut up, and pistol whip the creep. He falls in a heap, pathetic and crying. And I say, mister, get ready for dying. By the time his tears had gone and dried, he was trembling in fear and was fully hog-tied. So I knelt down over that little swine and cut off all his fingers, one at a time. And rolling him over to relish his grief, I took out my pliers to pluck out a few teeth. Stabbed him a few times by and by, but wasn't quite ready to let the creep die. So I stomped in his kneecaps and kicked in his face. Soon there was blood all over the place. So I sat down a moment to catch my breath and savor his pain as he lay bleeding to death. Then began to leave, but paused to say, I'll give your regards to your partner, AJ. Glancing over my shoulder as I walked away, I said goodbye and good riddance, and have a nice day. Thank you. make a girl, God takes sweetness and lace, adds ribbons and dimples and a smile for the face, a carefree laugh and a winsome wink, some giggles, some curls, and a touch of pink. Then he stirs in more love than there is tea in China, and to round it all out, he includes a vagina.
We're sorry.
Men are only good for fucking and beating. When you're tired of fucking them, there's only one thing left to do. After you fuck them, they start talking. That's when you beat them. They all talk too much, especially when you don't want to hear it. And what do they talk about? Violence toward women. But they fail to realize that their whining is what provokes most of the violence. They don't understand what their eternal screeching does to men. Shut up! We don't need to hit you! Just shut your mouths! One simple rule, guys. The first time she gives you some lip, bust it open wide. She won't talk shit again. Now that she's smart, she won't. Smack her mouth so hard she won't be able to open it for a month. It's difficult to bitch and moan and nag with a broken jaw, isn't it? Your fists are a judge's gavels. When she's in contempt, pound down on her until there's order in the court. Don't let her get away. Make her pay for being a woman. Such a sweet little girl. So annoying. Daddy's little snuggles. Now you're wiping the blood off your mouth. What would your father say if he saw me snap the snot out of your nose and onto the walls? Would he cry? Would he call the cops? He'd better not. I'll snatch that wooden cane out of his hand and beat him to death. Your brother says he wants to kick my ass? Let him try it. Let him just fucking try it. Tell him to bring his friends too, because I'm in a killing mood. Oh, you want to start shit yourself? Very funny. You're a woman. Made like a girl. I like to punch women and kick them and shove them up against walls. I like grabbing them by their pretty hair and swinging them into door frames, rubbing their noses in the carpet like they're puppies, dragging them into the bathroom and half drowning them in the toilet. Since either bathroom or kitchen sets are real good, because you can knock out a whole row of teeth when you slam a woman's face into one. Watch all the gooey blood dripping onto the white porcelain. It's a real treat. I destroy everything that's important to women. I smash their glass figurines and rip the stuffing out of their teddy bears. Then I shred their love letters into little ribbons as they watch and cry. The only solution to the female problem? Loudish, pig-like, male force. Ain't nothing wrong with women that a good backhand won't solve. Punch her in the stomach until she doubles over and wheezes. Crush her nose with one shot. Throw her up against your fish tank. Break things. Break everything. Smash telephones, destroy appliances, and kick down doors. Neighbors will call the cops. Shout threats to her as they hustle you into the squad car. She takes out a restraining order. That won't stop you. Women are on the receiving end. And we all know 'tis better to give. Females are egg-bearing brine shrimp. Sex objects. Men are the nouns. Fucking is the verb. Women are the direct objects. Two-dimensional. Why kid around? Women are defined by those cunts and nothing else. They were fashioned by nature as achingly beautiful mannequins. Dead girls in store windows. Victims. See all the dead lilies in the trash can behind the flower shop. Fragile blossoms. Used. Decaying. Women. Weak. Very pretty in their weakness. Ugly otherwise. Don't give her power. She doesn't know how to handle it. Women are intriguing little house pets, but they need to be tamed. Keep her chained down. Break the chain and watch her walk all over you. And you deserve it, because you gave away your power for free. Women say they're looking for nice guys, but they don't respect passive pussy men. Women want their lovers to be killers. Give them what they want. Women get beaten because they're so easy to beat. 5,000 trailers all over America tonight. Get a police scanner and listen to all the domestic violence calls. Blasts of static, street addresses, ages and races of suspects, what they're wearing. Do you need backup? Police dispatchers always have a flat, flavorless tone in their voices. They don't convey the violence. The desperate, vicious couples. The shirtless, sweaty men with their mouths hanging open. The sobbing women holding paper towels to their bleeding, mad scalps. The screaming, Tear Street kids running around in shitty diapers. The lacerated emotions. Such a scene demands violence to restore order. The cops can't beat everyone. Domestic violence picks up the slack. All the battered women in all the battered women's shelters. Swollen eyes, fat lips, cracked ribs. Pressured illusions. Love's sweet promise broken a million times over. Crying that they still love him. Keeping it together for the kid's sake. He says he's sorry, she forgives him. He finds a job. They get back together and it's nice for a while. Then he beats her with a tire jack until her ribs puncture her lungs. Dead promise. Dead wife. Two teenagers wander into the woods away from a keg party. They stop in the mossy darkness. I love you forever, she tells him. They lock tongues together. He reaches down and unzips her pants. She asks him to stop. He doesn't. She struggles. He pulls a knife from his boot and slices a deep red notch running from her throat down to her pussy. She falls to the forest floor, splashing blood onto the autumn leaves. He covers her mouth and fucks her ass. He blows his jam up her fudge hole as she dies. She asks for it. That's how he sees it anyway. And his opinion is the only one that matters. You wouldn't listen to a woman, would you?
Twisting, producing horrifying burns, blank pop-out eyes, fear-riddled, pleas laughable and denied, extreme pleasures derived from your suffering, your defeat, demanding an I love you only delays the inevitable scream for help. Ribcage snaps as knees work their control magic. Howling husk all alone, you tremble beneath me. Don't kill me, please, dear God, don't kill me, you scream over and over again. You don't want me to kill you? Why? What do you have to live for? Come on, you filthy pig. Tell me, what do you have in your life that's worthwhile? Do you have plans to shit out a child? Is that it? To puke out someone you can vicariously live your life through? What does the word useless mean to you? Please, sweet Jesus, please, no, no. Ah, no more fighting you. What, you think just collapsing into a little ball is somehow going to stop all of this? What does the word pity mean to you? Doesn't mean a whole hell of a lot to me. Muffled thud as heavy boot connects with the left side of face. Vomit crisscrosses her swollen features. Left eye already swollen shut. You don't want me to kill you? Well, let's see here. That's it. How about I blind you? You'll still be able to get around. Smelling and hearing will be great. I've heard there are many wonderful services offered to the less fortunate. Seeing eye dogs? And you can teach your patient loser friends how to read Braille. How does that grab you, huh, you filth? Oh, I'm sorry. How does that sound, ma'am? I'm doing you a favor, you know. Think of all the attention you'll get from this. Flowers, cards, bowls of fruit, Tiny Tim records, but no books to read while recovering in the hospital, because you won't have eyes to see with, my dear, sweet, misguided Eve. You plucked the wrong apple tonight, piggy. Tastes good. Does it not?
Flywheels, watch the drawers, hug the astronaut, the more grotesque the act.
I'm not a tolerant person. In fact, I get more intolerant by the day. I just find it more and more difficult to tolerate assholes. As my tolerance decreases, their numbers seem to increase. Every day there's more and more of them, and every day I have less and less patience. I'm not a mere bigot, but I certainly don't cut any slack to anyone on the merit of their status as an oppressed minority. Your people were enslaved? Tough luck. The white man stole your land? Too fucking bad. Your fair sex is plagued by date rape? Grin and bear it. These days everyone has a sob story, and frankly, I don't care. It's no excuse for being an asshole. We live in the age of the excuse. We live in the age of the asshole. They're everywhere. They come in all shapes, all sizes, all colors. They're black assholes, white assholes, women assholes, men assholes, queer assholes, straight assholes, smart assholes, stupid assholes, suburban assholes, inner city assholes, homeless assholes, upwardly mobile assholes, lazy assholes, incompetent assholes, sloppy assholes, anal assholes, and so it goes, ad nauseam. Why should I tolerate any of them? Why should I tolerate anything I don't care for any length of time? Why should I pretend it's okay? I don't like assholes. Don't like talking to them. Don't like talking about them. Don't like knowing them. Don't like knowing about them, or their thoughts, or their deeds. Assholes are like bad ideas. If you let even a single one into your life, it can begin to ruin things. It can destroy what's good and foster much that's bad. Why tolerate that? Tolerance was a virtue once. No more. There aren't enough hours in the day to tolerate all the assholes, to tolerate all the indignities hurled your way and still be able to live a decent life. Perhaps Goethe said it best, "That which disturbs your soul, you must not suffer." Remember that when it seems like assholes are hard at work to disturb your soul 24 hours a day. Take a tip from Mr. Intolerance. Don't permit them to.
I am man. Sometimes I cry. I am man. Sometimes I laugh. Sometimes I sigh. I am man. Sometimes I wonder aloud. Sometimes I goof on clouds. And sometimes I goof on clouds of pillow soft. With you. And sometimes I wave at people I don't know. And sometimes I wave at school buses, all full of eager, fresh faces. But my youth, my why is a sky blue days are gone. I'm a man now. Instead of waving at the bus, I throw rocks, hoping I shatter a window or two, causing splintered, broken glass to explode into the terrified, frightened children's faces. I'm a man now, causing horrible, painful lacerations. I'm a man. Sometimes I hate. And sometimes I hate and hate and hate. And sometimes I am a man. And sometimes I hate. And sometimes I'm hate. Sometimes I'm a man. I am hate.
Thank you.
Love will change the world. That's what we were told in the 60s. Love will make you happy. Love one another. Love makes the world go round. All you need is love. We've talked of love nonstop for the last few decades. Actually, for the last few thousand years. Where exactly has it gotten us? Are we one step closer to paradise? Hardly. Love hasn't stopped war, cured crime, or erased poverty. Hasn't even come close. Look for any sign of improvement, and I guarantee you, you'll see only the most cosmetic of changes. Window dressing, empty symbolism, fatuous fal-de-ral. But things are getting better all the time, the Lobniks assure us. What about peace in the Mideast? What about harmony in South Africa? Sure, there's peace in the Mideast, in between bombings. And there's plenty of harmony in South Africa if you're wealthy enough to live behind electrified fences and locked gates. In reality, things have turned to shit. Social and moral decay is like an out-of-control cancer that's taken charge. Cancer born of love. If some people are actually stupid enough to believe things are improving, it's only because their poor brains are so benumbed by love that they can no longer think straight. Love. Sickly love. Brotherly love. Unconditional love. Cowardly love. Geek love. A love that says relinquish judgment. A love that encourages acceptance at the expense of discernment. It's no wonder people imagine things have changed for the better, when in fact all that's changed is their capacity to accept any amount of shit, unconditionally. So the verdict on love is both bad and good. The bad news is that love has turned the world into a sewer. The good news is people have learned to love the smell of shit.
Thank you, Mr. Roberts, for calling Hatesville Suicide Hotline once again. Now, you've been a naughty boy. You're confused. Your resolve is wavering. Now, you've discussed this decision with other people, other groups, other individuals. Now, we know their agenda is to act as shills for pharmaceutical firms. They need live, desperate bodies, live and desperate, Mr. Roberts, to sell their potions and their expensive counsel. These hypocrites will try to make it seem that all you need right now is a friendly ear and a liter of salty tears to wash down their expensive hypnotic drugs to bind your paycheck to their will. Now, Mr. Roberts, you can rest assured that we at Hatesville Suicide Hotline are not guided by such fiduciary concerns. We applaud your decision to bring your useless, painful, and unproductive life to a swift and conclusive end. Now, you are in pain, Mr. Roberts. Life itself is intolerable. You are unimaginative. Life does not provide you enjoyment. You are useless, Mr. Roberts. Let's face facts. You are unproductive. It is imperative to respect your instincts and complete the act. Now, you've had our instructions for several weeks now. Look at chapter 6. Not the garrote. Swallow the pills. Slice the veins. Puff the poison. Pull the trigger. Be done with it. Be done with it quickly, cleanly, definitively. But before you go, we at Hatesville Suicide Hotline have one last suggestion. Now that you've made up your mind, Mr. Roberts, you've made up your mind. You have nothing left to lose but your boredom. Why not enjoy the time that remains? Dispatch those who annoy you to Never Never Land. Take them with you, Mr. Roberts. Why not start with those shills, those sob sisters? Think of it, Mr. Roberts. You'll never hear them so sincere as when you cock the trigger of your pistol aimed at their temple. You might enjoy the new you so much as to discover a reason to postpone your plans. Well, thank you, Mr. Roberts, for calling Hatesville Suicide Hotline. Our voicemail options are as follows.
For names and addresses of annoying pests, press 1 now. For suicide instructions by credit card, press 2 now. For notes left by satisfied customers, press 3 now. Have a happy day.
When I desire a lazy day, there's a place that I go to, not so far away. But it's distant from concrete and noise and strife, and far, far removed from the frictions of life. It's a place with no pests, but for spiders and chiggers, with no loudmouth assholes or unruly niggers. Just grassy fields and brooks that babble. No witless or homeless or other such rabble. And often my respite, alone with the calm, I pray for some despot to drop the A-bomb.